Hello, and welcome to my session titled Simplifying Application Management Using Custom Schemas in Configuration Profiles. My name is Leonardo Cassiopo, and I am an Apple Endpoint Engineer at Argonne National Laboratory. Prior to Argonne, I also spent approximately 8 years in education in both K-12 and higher ed. Today, I'll be going over some background information on the historical methods of configuring custom settings for applications in Jamf Pro, a few of the built-in options that already exist, using custom JSON schemas to configure those settings for applications that aren't built-in, and a brief introduction to writing JSON schemas for those applications. So before Jamf Pro version 10.18, the primary method for configuring custom settings for applications was by uploading a plist file to Jamf Pro. This was a common workflow for people, but the one issue with it was that whenever modifications or changes needed to be made, typically you had to re-upload a plist file to replace the one that was already there. Now, this meant that you would have to either keep track of that plist file for uploading at a future date, or be able to reconfigure it pretty easily in order to do that. I want to give an example of a plist file for those that may be unfamiliar. A plist or a preference list is just a text file on macOS that's displayed in XML and contains preferences for a given application. For example, if you were to go into an application like a web browser and configure things like the home page, whether or not the application were to auto update, or any other things that you may modify in the preferences of an application, that application is likely writing out those preferences to a preference list file so that it can refer back to them at a later time when it needs to revert back to those settings when you reopen the application. Enforcing these via configuration profile is just mandating those settings for computers in your environment. In here, you'll see that these are just stored in arrays and keys. And I want to point out a few of these in particular so that we can refer and call back to them later during the presentation to show the similarities between a plist and a JSON schema. The first key I want to point out is this AD domain key, which you'll see is stored as a string value. And the second one, this deny local key, you'll see it just has the word true under it. Sometimes you'll see just the word true or false, and sometimes you'll see this explicitly defined as a Boolean value. But again, this is just a bit of formatting that we're just trying to remember for when we call back to it later. Things started to change a little bit in Jamf Pro version 10.18. That was when the native Office 365 management options were built into that Applications and Custom Settings menu. This process was great, and now those settings for things like Microsoft Auto Update could be configured via this point-and-click interface that made creating and changing those settings very easy. The feature further expanded in Jamf Pro 10.19, when not only did this feature exist for Microsoft Office, it also existed for a few Jamf applications and also introduced the ability to use custom JSON schemas so that you could upload or copy and paste in a JSON schema and configure the settings for any application that you wanted. I was surprised that I didn't know about this sooner. So for a comparison, I want to show you a snippet from a JSON file, also for Nomad Login, like the original plist file was. Now, this may look very different from the XML view of the plist file, but they are largely focused on the same data. Under the Properties section here, you'll see that it has the exact same AD domain key, which is, again, shown as a string type. And you'll see the deny local key also exists here, defined as a Boolean, that true-false type. Whether a setting is configured via a preference list, whether it's done via JSON, they're going to apply in the same way. The main difference here is using these JSON schemas allows you to work in a nice graphical user interface within Jamf Pro to create and change those settings. This especially becomes very user-friendly if you have other non-technical users changing those settings for different applications. In Jamf, we're going to have a few different ways of utilizing those JSON schemas. We have the built-in options, which include some Jamf applications and external applications, but those are the ones that won't exactly show you the JSON behind the interface. They are just automatically built into Jamf Pro. And then we'll have the custom schemas, which are the ones that you can upload yourself. In regards to built-in applications, we'll start with the Jamf applications. Started by navigating to Configuration Profiles and creating a new one with a Application and Custom Settings payload. We can click on Jamf Applications, and then we can choose from the different application domains that are available. Currently, that includes things like Jamf Connect and Compliance Reporter. Once we would select the application domain, the version, and the variant, we'd be met with the point-and-click interface to configure the settings for that application. Very similar to that, we have the external applications, but the ones that are built into Jamf Pro. Again, started by going to creating a new configuration profile, one with an application and custom settings payload, but instead of Jamf applications, we would choose external applications. When choosing the source of Jamf repository, we would see the ones that are automatically built into Jamf. This includes things like Google Chrome, Microsoft Office, and Microsoft Auto Update. But again, after choosing the application, the version, and the variant, we get met with that point-and-click interface for each of those unique applications and the settings that are possible to configure for them. The one different one here is this custom schemas option. It works. The setup of it is very similar to the external applications. The main difference is when you create the custom settings payload and go to external applications, instead of Jamf repository, you would choose custom schema, and you would be met with an add schema button. From here, you could copy and paste in the JSON file itself, or you can upload the JSON file here. There's plenty of applications that you can do this for, including Nomad, Zoom, Firefox, BBEdit, and many more. Many of these applications already have JSON schemas created by the manufacturer or others in the community. Once saving that screen, you get met with that point-and-click interface. You'll see here, I have a demonstration of it with Nomad login. And you'll see the same keys that we were defining in the plist file and in the JSON file earlier are right here in nice form fields and dropdown values. That Active Directory domain shows up as a fillable form field that you can just type in whatever the string is. And the Deny Local Users has a dropdown with the options of true and false, since that was configured as a Boolean value. The nice thing here is, if any changes need to be made, modifications, it's as easy as going back into the configuration profile, modifying those text fields or dropdowns, and saving the configuration profile. You would then be prompted on if you want to redeploy that out to your entire fleet, and can choose to do so or not from there. One of my favorite examples of this is the Mac Admin's Nudge tool, if anyone is using that, to update the operating system on their macOS devices. Since that is commonly updated to enforce a new operating system version or to change the date by which it needs to be installed, if you use the JSON schema for configuring Nudge, it's as simple as going back into the configuration profile, modifying those settings, and clicking Save to have it redeployed out. One of the other nice features here is the plist preview button. When you press the plist preview button, it shows you what this would look like as a plist file. Now you'll see this looks very similar to the plist file that we started with at the beginning of this presentation. Again, we have that AD domain key shown as a string and that deny local key showing with true as a Boolean value. This is all just showing you the plist format of the configuration profile. So it's really easy to see that it's enforcing the same exact settings. It's just a cleaner and an easier method to do so with a user interface that more people can understand. Now, you may be saying that you don't know how to write JSON, and that's totally fine. The main reason I wanted to present on this was to bring attention to the fact that there are already plenty of JSON schemas that already exist and are available to use without you needing to know how to write JSON, because once they're pasted in, you'll be met with the drop-down menus for configuring those settings. For this reason, I wanted to bring attention to the Jamf Custom Profile Schemas GitHub, a collection of these JSON files written by the community that you can use in your own environment, should you choose. I stumbled across this in a Jamf Nation discussion board post while working on making settings for supported browsers. I originally went down this path when I was trying to figure out how to configure settings for all the supported browsers at my workplace. In a Jamf discussion board post, I found a link to a JSON schema that had been made by Microsoft for Microsoft Edge, and came across this link to the schemas on GitHub. Going through the repositories, I found that other Mac admins had already created schemas for applications like Firefox, Nomad, BBEdit, and countless others. For that reason, I want to make sure that I plug that GitHub so others can take advantage of these already written JSON files as well. So here is the QR code for the links to those repositories on GitHub. And I'll leave this up on the screen for a moment. Again, the benefits here is that you don't need to go and try to reinvent the wheel for a lot of these common applications, as a peer may have already taken the time to create the JSON file. And though you don't have to be able to write JSON files to use these, if you understand plist files or are comfortable with those at all, you'll be able to look at these files and get an understanding of what they do or what settings they're enforcing. You can always also rely on that plist preview button in the configuration profile screen to see which settings are being enforced when you change anything. Of course, this list on GitHub is not exhaustive and may not have a certain application that you would like to use it for, but that also opens the opportunity, if you're interested, to create your own JSON schema to use. And if you decide, publish it to GitHub for others in the community to use as well. So that brings me to the last part of the presentation, which is constructing your own JSON schema. For me, the application I wanted to use this for was Nomad Login, which is why most of my examples in this presentation have been structured around that application. The way I initially went about creating the JSON schema for it was looking through that GitHub and following the format that others had used and trying to replace it with the different keys and types that Nomad Login needed in order to be configured. It was only when I was more than halfway through that process did I come across an application made to simplify that process called Managed App Schema Builder. So I wanted to give a brief walkthrough of that application and how it works. This is the Managed App Schema Builder application, and this is what it looks like. So when we're creating a JSON schema, the first couple things we need to do is input a preference domain and a domain description. Since we're doing Nomad Login in this example, the preference domain is menu.nomad.login.ad, and this will be unique based off the application that you're configuring the settings for. The domain description, I just put Nomad Login. Once we're ready, we can click the plus sign in the lower left-hand corner and create a key. We get prompted for the value of what preference key we'd like to create. In this case, we'll create that AD domain key that we've been working with. Once we click Add, we get prompted and we can add a few more settings. You'll see on the left side that AD domain key now shows up in the list of keys. And we have to fill out a few things, including the key friendly name, a description of the key, and the type. The key friendly name is more just for your information. If AD domain is something that you think you needed to clarify to make it more obvious what needed to be put in there, you could change the key friendly name to Active Directory domain, or whatever would make sense for you to understand what that setting is enforcing. the description of the key. You can put in a description of what it does, what the options of the values in that field could be, or even a link to a support website that may define what the keys are and what options may be. And finally, you have the drop-down field that shows the type. In this case, AD domain is a string value. Once we're done with an individual key, we can press the plus sign again to create additional keys. So for a second one, I did the migrate key, for example. For Nomad login, that's the setting where if you have mobile directory bound users with Active Directory, this setting would migrate them to a local account. So again, we're putting in a key friendly name, a description of the key, and a type. In this case, we have a Boolean value. The dropdown here that shows the different types can be configured with a string, a Boolean value, an integer, whatever the specific key needs to be for that manufacturer can be selected there in that dropdown value. Once we're done, we can click the Save button on the lower right-hand corner, and we'll be prompted to save this to whatever location on the computer we want. Now, the nice part about this is we can use this for two different things. Option one is, if you want to come back to this later and create additional keys, you can open up an existing JSON file that you've created in this application and continue where you left off or add additional keys that you may need. The other option is, you can either open that file and copy and paste the raw content directly into Jamf, or you can upload that file to Jamf at that application and custom settings screen where you're adding the JSON schema. And this is already in a format that's compatible with Jamf. So it makes it really easy to create those JSON schemas, especially if they're simple ones where you only need to configure a couple keys. So again, I wanted to plug this application as well. So this QR code leads to the GitHub of the Managed App Schema Builder application. If you think this is something that'd be beneficial to you, here's where the repo is located, where you can download the software to make your own JSON schemas. I've found this super helpful, especially in learning the formatting of a JSON schema, where I can look at the file after it's created as well. This link will also be on my next slide with the references as well. So this is just a few references and handy links that you can reference if you're trying to use JSON schemas in your own environment. The first one is jsonschema.org. It has a lot of background information, formatting. It has a nice getting started guide. So if you're trying to learn more about JSON schemas in general, that's a great starting point. Secondly, jsonlint.com is a great formatting checker for JSON files. It's helped me out a lot a couple times when I've had either a rogue or a missing bracket or parenthesis or a comma. This can check the formatting if you're getting an error in Jamf Pro when you try to paste it in, saying that you're in an incorrect format. And then again, the two links to the GitHub projects of the Jamf custom profile schemas and the managed app schema builder. I hope that you have found value in this information and that you might be able to have these schemas help you in your environment as much as they helped me. Thank you for your time and thank you for listening.